Hi everyone. Before I launch into the presentation, I just wanted to take this opportunity to introduce myself. My name is Deborah Pownley, and I'm a final year PhD candidate in psychology. My focus is on adaption and recovery for male and female victims of domestic abuse, although my research has taken a particular focus on male victims of intimate partner violence. I'd also like to take this opportunity to say thank you to for allowing me to present this data today. But particularly, I'd like to say thank you to all the men that were trusted enough with their story and their data to allow me to analyse this and use it to present this data to you today and to present to various frontline users. Even in lockdown, I was invited to present this to over 1,000 people already that are frontline users and people with a particular interest in domestic abuse. So thank you very much for that. Today, being International Men's Day, I also wanted to send a message out to those men that are being abused by their female partners and let them know that we do hear you, we do believe you, and we are really fighting hard to make sure that there's the laws, the funding and policies and even social belief is shown and educated that domestic abuse and intimate partner violence is not a gendered issue and never has been. So, again, thank you for this opportunity and I hope you enjoy the presentation. The title of my presentation today is The Male Victim Study: Bursting the Gendered Myths. And this took place during lockdown that began in March of this year. And I had a study about to go live called Walking to Recovery, which many of you have already supported. Because of the lockdown, that couldn't go ahead and has been furloughed until we're out of COVID-19. But on the day that Boris put us into lockdown, I scribbled out a survey of quite large proportions, actually, that I would like to ask male victims of domestic abuse if I had them locked down in their homes with screens in front of them. So these are some of the results from that rather large survey. The agenda for today's presentation focuses around four key points. Firstly, why investigate the experiences of male victims? And that can sound like a bit like teaching you guys to suck eggs, but this is something that I drive home time and time again because outside of this particular arena, many of you know, but most of you could guess that sometimes you need to really drive home the context of how important it is to actually acknowledge male victims and their experiences. I'm going to quickly talk through what the survey examined. This is going to be very top line because, as I said previously, it was a very large survey. Give you some pertinent results that are focused around some of the myths that come along with the gendered model of domestic abuse. And then give you a top line of the next steps that are currently in progress. So, why investigate male victims? So, in the UK, the Office of National Statistics reports that one in three victims of domestic abuse are men, which equates currently to 786,000 men. And if we use the general population demographics from the UK, because the perpetrator is not often reported in these statistics. But using the population demographics, we could estimate that At least 740,000 of those victims are victims of female perpetrated domestic abuse. And we also have evidence that shows that men are three times less likely to report. So if we factor in that nugget of information, not only would we expect equal numbers of male victims coming forward, we would probably see slightly higher results, which is good news out of a very dark subject, but I'm sure you know what I mean. So last year in the UK, we saw partner violence increase by 180,000. And this was shouted in our press and across our media. And the usual suspects were trotted out, and they explained that this was an absolutely hideous issue for female victims of domestic abuse, and how we really needed to make sure we got a grasp of this gendered model. However, if you dig down a little bit into the actual statistics, again, that came through from the Office of National Statistics, you'll find that that increase was due to 29,000 extra women coming forward to report being victims of domestic abuse. But it was almost tripled by men coming forward, and 79,000 additional men had come forward, which was an increase of 2.7 to 1 as a ratio of male victims to female victims. Beyond this, we all know that there is a huge amount of scientifically robust data that shows that women are as or even slightly more likely to commit domestic abuse as men. And despite having all these facts and figures, there is scarcity of research that looks at the experiences of male victims. So what we find is that a lot of the data that's put out there, a lot of the myths that are put out there, are assumptions about men, when the studies that are used have only ever included female victims, which was one of the reasons I wanted to get this study out there, is to balance that rather biased assumption. So what did the survey measure? Again, I'm not going to go into too much detail here, but I think a little will help. It was a blend of closed and open text questions. So there were questions that needed a yes or no answer. And then I asked participants if they could expand on their answers. And some people could answer in a sentence, and some people could answer in pages of text, all of which was extremely valuable. Included in the survey were four psychological scales, all of which are very well tested and used across various studies. But what these psychological scales gave me was a snapshot of the experience of male victims from the controlling behaviour scale, which measured, does what it says on the tin, measured the controlling behaviours that were suffered or taken part of within the relationship. The impact of event scale that measured the post-traumatic stress symptomology of male victims. The brief cope scale, which measures 14 different types of coping mechanisms that include positive and negative coping mechanisms. So things like substance abuse, active coping, denial, emotional support, and acceptance. And that scale is used over various trauma for various types of victims. And then the post-traumatic growth inventory, which measures positive adaptation to traumatic events. As far as I'm aware, that scale has only ever been used on one study of victims of domestic abuse. And that was, I think, 40 or 60 women. But it's not widely used in domestic abuse because domestic abuse victims are not assessed for their adaption. It is one of those traumas that's framed to be permanently negative, having a negative impact on victims, which I think does victims a disservice, as well as can keep them in victimhood. And then I also included a number of questions that challenge the gendered research, which is what I'm going to talk to you about today. Firstly, the location of the participants. In all, I was hoping to get a couple of hundred participants, maybe from the UK, but around 200 was what I was hoping for, that would give me robust numbers to do analysis on. And thanks to the support of you guys, we got far more than that. We got a total of 1,347 participants from all over the world. And the four that are here are just the largest ones. Most surprising to me were the number of male participants from India, with 369. As far as I'm aware, that in and of itself is a large grouping, but also an extremely strong grouping for research of Indian men, which I hope to share across any government or service provider in India. In the UK, we got 286, 212 from Australia, and 168 from the USA. But as I said, altogether, 1,347 participants. It blew me away, actually. Now, I also took a look at the age range and the occupation of male victims. You'll see in the occupation side that the most dominant occupation of participants was computer and mathematics. And that was skewed for two reasons, really. One, because of the number of participants from India, where computing and computer service agencies are a really dominant industry there. But also because I released this survey over Twitter and Facebook. So you would expect a skew towards people being online and maybe towards that particular type of occupation. But you can see that there was male participants from every type of occupation, including transportation, management, construction, business and finance, education and training, installation, arts and social media, entertainment, sports and media, and life and social sciences. There was not really an occupation that wasn't touched upon by male victims, which is not surprising in any way, but obviously because of the scarcity of research around male victims is often missed and never discussed. For Australia, for example, the occupation that had the most participants in the survey was construction, which is often labelled as one of those occupations where obviously has a high suicide rate for men, but is often been labelled as a toxic occupation. That's very male dominated and all the rest of it, where actually what we saw from Australia was it was also the occupation that had the most male participants that had been victims of female perpetrated abuse. So one of the questions, and I'm going to talk through three here today, one of the myths that is put forward about men and domestic abuse by the gendered model is that men can just leave. They can just pick up all their stuff and leave because they don't have any responsibility at all to the children. They are the primary earners, so they've got all this access to finances, so they can just up and leave. So how could they possibly be victims of domestic abuse in the way that women have? That's a myth, because when I asked the question, are you still in the abusive relationship, a quarter of the participants, 26% to be exact, said that they were still in the abusive relationship. So I asked the question, the follow-up question, what's stopping you leaving? I didn't ask it in the way of why don't you just leave, because that's typical of someone that doesn't understand the situation. And I think it's victim blaming. But I think the question needs to be asked, and often it's not that you're staying out of want, it's that you are staying because there are barriers preventing you from leaving. Some of those barriers were given by the male victims, included, I would lose my children if I left. And that would mean that men would have nowhere to go to take their children. There are no shelters for men, let alone those that also provide for children. And then the dominant narrative, certainly in the UK, is that mother ends up being the primary carer, and fathers more often than not are seen as the non-custodial parent, which is not out of want for most men. So losing their children, and knowing that that tends to be what happens through our judicial system, prevented men from actually leaving them. Another one to do with the children was about protecting them from harm. I've one of the cases that really got to me, and there were many, was a gentleman that had been in the relationship for around 37 years, and he'd only left in the last year or so. And when I looked at his reasons for staying, when I asked him, okay, so what finally let you leave? His answer was that the final daughter had got married and left home, was in a stable relationship. And he'd stayed for those 37 years because he was worried that his abusive wife would then perpetrate the abuse onto the children. So he stayed and made sure that that didn't happen. Quite outstandingly, that is different from what we tend to hear from female victims of domestic abuse. Because again, there's this idea that mum's going to get the primary care position anyway. And I don't think, and this is just me hypothesizing here, just based on what I've read, I haven't got any hard references. I don't think that's a factor when women leave, because they have places to go to take their children with them. But the next reason for men staying was that there was nowhere to go. Often you are isolated with domestic abuse, so you don't have any friends and family to turn to. And you're also really embarrassed, and you know, how do you start that conversation? But also there's no provision. And if there is, it's either way out of where you live, so you wouldn't even get the opportunity to go and see your children and check that they're okay. But you certainly couldn't take children, because there is no provision for that. Another reason was that their life was completely controlled, every element of it. Men were saying that what they wore was controlled, who they spoke to was controlled, their telephones were controlled, their computers, all their passwords had to be known to their perpetrator. Every single aspect of their life was controlled. So there wasn't even the cognitive space, let alone the finances or the actual breathing space to leave. Every part of their life was controlled. There was also love and commitment. Some of the male participants said that they still actually loved their partner, and they thought it was their duty to stay and try to help them. And also that they'd taken their marriage vows very seriously, and because of that, it was for better or worse. And that's exactly what they were staying for. Hope, was a big factor, that they hoped it would get better. There was a number of reasons that some men put forward, that their partner had had a very poor upbringing, or that she was going through menopause, or they'd had a baby and they thought hormones or postpartum depression was involved. But they were hoping that the future would be brighter. And then, of course, there's shame. It is very shameful for any victims of domestic abuse to admit to themselves that they are in an abusive relationship, let alone to actually go somewhere and have to talk about that, and then come to terms with actually you made marriage vows or you made a commitment to a partner, and that's over. It's difficult. Another myth that is often put forward by those that promote the gendered model of domestic abuse is that men don't reach out for help. So I ask the question, have you told anyone about the abuse? And 82% of men said they had. Some of them had reached out to more formal agencies, which included solicitors. Very few had reached out to the police, and then many of them had reached out to friends and family and actually used that as a support mechanism. But those 18% that hadn't told anyone about the abuse, I asked, why haven't you? And these are some of the reasons that came through, and you'll recognize these, how common these are. And sadly, how true they are. So the first one is nobody would listen. And it's unsurprising that you would think that. There's no provision for men. And in the UK, we're currently going through the domestic abuse bill is going through court that will see domestic abuse as a crime solidified in its own sense. Currently, various other laws deal with the fallout of domestic abuse. So things such as harassment laws, battering laws, assault laws. The domestic abuse bill would see domestic abuse actually cemented into law as a crime unto itself. And within that, there's still cries for it to be a gendered model. And albeit that the language of the bill is not gendered, the language of the guidance of how that bill will be used and processed through the criminal justice system is very gendered, right from the very beginning. So it's unsurprising that male victims would not think that anyone would listen to them. Another reason just goes to show the chivalry of men, even when they are being put in physical and psychological danger. And that was that they didn't want to shame their partner. They didn't want to have others think badly of the woman that they'd committed to, and often the mother of their children. They didn't want their children to feel badly about their mother. So they were taking on the burden themselves. Again, one of the most dominant reasons was, who would believe me? There was even men that said, I'm a big bloke. I work in construction, or I do all. I'm very strong. I'm over 6 foot tall. Who's going to believe me? Or a man like me is abused. We know that they are, and we know the reasons why they're not believed, sadly. There was an overriding belief that no one cares about men, and that makes me sad on so many levels, but clearly a lot of people do care about men, and there's a very noisy element of those that support the gendered model that have sadly got control at the moment, which is something we're trying to put right. But I can totally understand why men think that. It also saddens me when I look at my own son and stepsons because I think, really, do I believe that anyone cares about men? And what happens if they find themselves in that position? And that's something I think we need to tell more mothers. God help your son if he's ever in that position. Hope he isn't, but I'm sure that he would very much feel the same as the men in this study did. And I also think this is something really important, and another drum that I bang often, which is the last reason here, which is the services are not appropriate to men. I think that the services are not appropriate to a lot of people, but predominantly men. We have to remember that this is a service sector that is set up by women for women, and then complains that men don't reach out and want help from this female-centric process. No, I can totally understand why. But that just goes to show that men do reach out, and the reasons that the men that don't reach out give are not indicative of men, but indicative of the environment around them. So to blame them for not actually reaching out to get help is another part of victim blaming and another myth that's put forward. This one is probably the biggest myth of why those that support the gendered model campaign for women to get more support than men. And the myth is that men don't feel fear or get injured. Some of the answers that I saw in my data made me cry or made me feel sick or made me very cross. And sometimes all three at once. And what tends to happen in feminist-based research is that they don't define what fear is. They just say that women are more frightened of being injured, or women are more frightened of their partner or being murdered or whatever. But it and then again, without using any men in the study at all, it will just be assumed that men don't feel fear or get injured in the same way as women do. I can categorically say from my data and based on this data, that's untrue. And that's the kindest way I can put it without swearing. But I asked the question, are or were you afraid of your partner or ex-partner? And 75% of the men that answered my survey said yes. So I asked them, why? Why were you frightened of your partner or ex-partner? And these are some of the reasons, and I'm going to read them out because I think when you just hear these verbalised, how sickening they are. And what the first one we've touched on in the previous slide, which was fear of her hurting the children. And this was a real fear for men. As parents, we have protective, most of us have a parental protective mechanism for certainly our children and usually most children. But for men, it is biologically inbuilt and socially expected that men will stand in harm's way for women and children. We see it on the Titanic, we see it all over the place. Women and children first. Men are sacrifice themselves and stand in the way of harm for their children. And we see it in domestic abuse, that men stood in the way and took the domestic abuse to protect their children. Then there's things like she hit me and threatened to tell the police that I did it to her. If we ever got them involved, she threatened, I have recordings, to cry rape if I ever called the police on her. So you're totally disempowered in that situation because you know what's going to happen if she does call the police. We have mandatory arrests in America. There's even been evidence shown that if the police rock up and arrest the woman, they have three times the paperwork to fill in than if they arrest a man. and if you're a police person under pressure. I'm sure some will take the path of least paperwork. I'm sure it's something that would tempt me if I was in that situation, especially because the Duluth model, which is still very much used, maybe not called the Duluth model, also pushes the fact that every single person within the process of domestic abuse will be monitored and no doubt questioned if they don't follow correct procedure. Another reason, she has kicked me while I had a catheter in and the use of only one arm, tried to stab me, tried to hit me with a bottle, almost had me beat up by several members of her family acting like I beat on her. So often men don't hit back because we train boys from a very early age not to hit girls, and we don't put any caveat on that. Often we'll say, it doesn't matter what she does, you don't hit a girl, you never hit a woman. But we never say that to girls, do we? And that leads to a situation where they will, quite frankly, get away with murder. Another reason was I was afraid she might kill me. One of the things that came through really strongly on my survey and in previous research is that women weaponize, and they weaponize using ordinary household objects. A gentleman in my survey had issues 10 years on with sleeping properly at night. And again, looking at his data, it was because his abusive ex-partner used to wake him up by pouring a boiling kettle on him. So the idea that women are always afraid of men because of a strength weight ratio is ridiculous when we're looking at someone with a weapon, a knife, or kicking you when you are unable to protect yourself, or stabbing you or attacking you when you're asleep. Another reason, I firmly believe she is capable of taking the life of me or the children without remorse. She is able to easily gaslight those in a position to help and turns them against me. It's horrendous that there are women out there that are harming men and children, yet are given the excuse of patriarchy or self-defense. And finally, starting by slapping me, grabbing me, pinching me, hitting me with bare hands, escalating to throwing objects, threatening me with knives, tipping boiling water over me, threatening to kill me in my sleep. Now, one of the psychological measures I mentioned at the beginning of the presentation was the impact of event scale. And what that measures is the PTSD symptomology. And in this survey, over half of the men that answered that scale scored over the threshold of what would be a concern to indicate scores that would lead to post-traumatic stress disorder. And out of the entire survey, a third of men scored high enough that would indicate that the PTSD symptomology was going to suppress their immune system's functioning and cause long-term physical damage to their bodies. So it's not just the actual physical violence that harms men in line with the harm that is put out regarding female victims, but also the psychological effects are not only very deep and severe, but also long-lasting enough to have an impact on your immune system that could shorten your lifespan, lead to heart disease, even coping mechanisms with alcoholism and all those sort of things. The impact is severe for male victims and cannot be dismissed in the research. So Those are just three areas that bust some of the myths that are put forward by the gendered model. Men can't just leave because they are terrified of what will happen to their children and their relationship with their children. They can't just leave because they've made a commitment that they take very seriously with their partner. And even if they did want to leave, where would they go? Men don't reach out for help. The data in this survey shows that they do. Unfortunately, there is very little help out there that fits their needs. And there's very little help out there, full stop. Where do they go when they're going to be believed? Often they can only reach out for to friends and family because not only are they terrified what's going to happen to their children, but they're terrified that they're going to be seen as a perpetrator. And then the myth that men don't feel fear or get injured, that is one of the ones that's used the most to gain favour, funding, and changes in policy and law. And data shows otherwise. Women weaponise and they attack men when they are at their most vulnerable, or they attack men knowing they're not going to be attacked back. Next steps. Complete full analysis of the data set. I'm looking at learning a couple of more techniques to get the very best out of this data set regarding the open questions that the male participants gave me, because I think we really need to make sure this is utterly robust and nailed. Following the last survey, I had many requests for translations to gain even more participants. So myself and Professor Nicola Graham-Kevin have developed a survey that will be out shortly, within the next week or so. Well, even actually, when you hear this presentation, I'm hoping it's going to be out there, and I'm going to leave it running till at least the end of November, just to make sure that you guys, if you're interested or know of friends that want to participate, please put them forward, point them in our direction. And this is purely focused on coercive control, which is again a new law in the UK. And that looks at abuse that doesn't necessarily include violence, but includes things like manipulation, isolation, financial abuse, psychological abuse, and sexual abuse. And so far, that is translated into 14 languages. Although I had a huge response from India, I was told through feedback that if it had been translated into Hindi, we could have got a heck of a lot more. So that's what we've done. But we've also included German, French, Italian, Polish, Portuguese, several others, about 14 languages altogether. So please share that if you can. You can find me on Twitter as Firebird Psych, and no doubt there'll be a link on there for the survey. For information and references, if you would like to use any of the information here and don't wish to contact me directly, please use the reference cited here, which is Powney, Graham, Kevin, and Willen 2020. But also be aware that the findings that I've shown you are preliminary, and are subject to changes, although I don't foresee any changes on the information I've shared here. I've shared a couple of the references that I think you might find important for the data I've presented here. So thank you very much, and have a great conference.